More live Clydesdale Premier League action on Friday night here on ESPN. Motherwell v Hibs, live Friday night from 7.
So this is what it's all about, the DTM Trophy 2012. Hello and welcome from the Hockenheimring. The sun is shining, we've got a full house. It's a perfect day for the final countdown. And we certainly saw a really nerve-wracking qualifying yesterday. And I'm sure the race today is going to be just as nerve-wracking. Fact is, Gary Peffert is ahead in the championship with 3 points. And he's also one position ahead of Bruno Spengler. Gary will be starting from P2 and Bruno Spengler will be starting from P3. And the battle certainly is going to be really, really exciting. And here are your commentators, Dave and Andrew.
Thanks very much, Farina. We're biting our nails up here in the commentary box. What a fantastic scene here. As you said, the sun is shining on this wonderful circuit here of Hockenheim. And let's look down on it with our Hankook animation and check out the speeds and the gears with all three manufacturers represented for this final animation of the year. And of course, the blast off from the start line into the fast right-hander in the race, the Nord curve, where there's a big runoff area on the outside. And then it's down to turn two, where there's always a lot of action. And it's fourth gear there. And then blasting away round the Parabolica corner. Long, long left-hander, lots of loads on the drivers there. And then picking your braking point into the hairpin, right down to first gear and 65 kilometers an hour. That's just over 30 miles an hour. Accelerating out of there, we need a lot of traction into another very fast right-hander, taken in fifth gear at 210 kilometers an hour, and then down into a long left-hand corner. Again, lots of loads on the car and a short blast then to the right-hander, which brings the cars back onto the old straight. And then up the gears to fifth place and the corner into the stadium, which is vitally important. Then down to the Sachs curve, which is banked round that. And then again, fighting for grip, fighting for traction, the left and then the right, and then it goes all the way right to the Sud curve. There they are through the Sud curve, maybe using a lot of curb there, and then to the start finish line, and amazingly all three cars finish side by side, Dave. Let's check out the starting grid, Dave.
Thank you, Andrew. Here we go then, the final about to get underway, and Augusto Farfus it is that is on pole alongside then the championship leader is Gary Paffett. Then we see Bruno Spengler on P3 with Matty Ekstrom P4. He looked good in warm-up this morning, did Matty Ekstrom. Then it's Joey Hand then, great starting position for him, P5. Martin Tomczyk alongside in P6. As we work our way down the grid, we see Dirk Werner and Edo Mortara there on P7 and P8. And then to Jamie Green, also mathematically in there with a chance, P9. Felipe Albuquerque is alongside. Then it's Rocky, Mike Rockefeller there with Christian Vitoris wearing the new gold colours on his Mercedes this weekend. Andy Prio also looked good in warm-up this morning down there, P13. Adrian Tombay alongside, taking a podium, of course, in Valencia. Rahul Frey then, grid 15, and Ralf Schumacher alongside the 16. Then we see Rob Wickens and Roberto Merry, 17 and 18. And then it's Miguel Molina and David Coulthard. Then as we get to the very back of the grid, we see Susie Wolf and Timo Scheider, Andrew.
Yeah, penalty for being underweight, but let's go down to the grid now with Farina.
I'm now here with Agosto Fafu, starting in pole position, and this reminds me completely of Valencia. What's going to happen? Do you think he can manage again to do a start finish, just like a victory, just like in Valencia?
Well, it would be a dream, to be honest, to have a race like Valencia. I think here the circumstances are different. The field is much more compact. What I really want is to get a good launch and enjoy my race. I think that's what I want. I'm here to enjoy my race. This is a brilliant event, last race of the year, so let's hope for a good start and a clean race.
All right, best of luck. I'll let you focus, and now back to you guys.
Yeah, thanks very much. And Farfus, a great character. Here's Jamie Green's just got an outside chance of that championship. To win it, he has to win the race. And yes, basically, Gary and Bruno have to finish up in a heap. And, you know, it could happen.
It could happen, Andrew.
It could happen. The winner there earlier in the season at the Norris Ring, his one victory of the year. But he won this race a year ago.
Yes, exactly the point I was going to make. There's Edo Mortara.
The only Audi driver to have won this season. Two victories to the man who might move into marketing when he's finished his racing career. But a tremendous buzz around this place, David. And the other thing we should mention, of course, last race ever in the DTM for Susie Wolf. And indeed for David Coulthard. He said he might do a few events at Goodwood, like the revival meeting, but basically his professional motor racing career is coming to a close today. And, you know, what a wonderful career it's been. The 13 Grand Prix victories amongst all his other accolades. So final preparations here. You can see the silver sheets just to try and keep the heat out of the cockpits. And of course, so many scenarios here. The possibility that maybe Farfus, the hairpin on the first lap, will just move over and let Bruno Spengler go sailing through. But one thing we've got to remember, there is a manufacturer's championship going on, and Audi lead that. In fact, they took the lead at Valencia, and that is very important to them, and they will be pushing their guys to get the best possible result. And Ekstrom has looked fast. Okay, he's only qualified fourth, but a lot of the time in practice he's been the fastest man out there, and I can see Eki being right in the mix here and maybe making it all a bit more complicated than we might expect. The thing about Farfus is, and Spengler, the thing about Spengler in particular, he's got several BMWs to help him, including Tomczyk, including Hand, and including Farfus. So there the grid girls are marching off with their boards. And as we were saying, as we look again at the grid, Farfus, second pole position in a row, and Gary Paffett, former champion, trying to make it two. Spengler has come close four, five times, and Ekstrom, a double champion. Joey Hand is best ever qualifying, and the reigning champion, Martin Tomczyk, going through the field. Was Vitoris, and Prio is the slowest of the BMWs, but it was only by fractions. Adrian Tambay in 14th, finished second 3 weeks ago.
Yes.
Ralf Schumacher, not sure about his future in the DTM. He may not continue. That could leave three seats at Mercedes-Benz to be filled.
So there is Joey Hand's car, as you say, best qualifying from Joey Hand. And just looking at this BMW, Andrew, they've come back into DTM this year, and whatever happens today, boy, has it been successful for them.
It's been successful for them, and it's been successful for the DTM. But let's get down to Verena with Norbert Haug.
Norbert Haug, this is going to be such an exciting race. Gary Peppert is in front of Bruno Spengler, which I bet is the most important. But how's your feeling on the race? I mean, this is it's all or nothing.
Yeah, well, it's a real showdown. It was like a real thriller yesterday. And I think it will continue today. Let's see who's got the best race speed and who's got the best start. Hopefully everything is clean and we see good sport and then we should be in good shape.
And I'm sure it's going to be very exciting. And also, Gary is kind of the lonely Mercedes-Benz ranger out there. I mean, they're 5 BMW in the top 7 and it's just him out there.
Yeah, that's right. But he can get the job done, that's for sure.
All right. Well, cross our fingers. Thank you very much, Norbert Haug. It's going to be so exciting. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Verena, and lovely to hear from Norbert Haug. That's the second, or if not third time, I've heard him mention about good sportsmanship, Andrew.
Yes, well, he's still smarting over Zandvoort, where he feels that Gary Paffett was taken off by Tomczyk. Tomczyk says, no, it was just an error. I think Norbert still thinks it might have been deliberate. Who knows? Here is Gary Paffett in the black BMW. Saw him down on the grid a little earlier with his wife and some of the family, and also Mark Blundell, the former Formula One driver who is part of Gary's management team. And of course, he has a long-term contract with Mercedes-Benz. That's a great shot from the helicopter down there. Here is the championship, just those 3 points now. 127 to Paffett, 124 to Spengler. Then it's Green on 109, and then the best of the Audi drivers, Mike Rockefeller, has 85, Ekstrom 81. So still bragging rights there for Audi, who can
very
be the
so
highest placed Audi driver at the end of the championship. Motara also in that hunt. Martin Tomczyk, the reigning champion, and the rest of the gang there. As we look at Farfus's car, well, he was stunningly fast 3 weeks ago, and was bouncing around the place. We see him in the BMW hospitality. He's always chatting to everyone. Man who really loves life. Big smile on his face. And interesting to see how he will play in this final chapter of the first season, of course, of the new DTM with the new high-tech carbon fiber cars. And of course, the three manufacturers and quite a lot of other changes we've seen this year, like the paddle shift and changed aerodynamics. So there is Norbert wandering around, long time director of motorsport for Mercedes-Benz. Not quite sure what all those hand signals are about. Is Paffett a bit worried on his grid position? There he is with his chief mechanic. Just wants it to, just a little bit worried about that. Have seen cars get drive-throughs before now for not being in the right position on the grid.
And the thing is, Andrew...
Yeah, well, that's spot on, isn't it, there?
Yeah. A lot can happen, and a lot is likely to happen, of course, as we see there the three championship contenders, if you like, Andrew, and where they're positioned on the grid. What we've got to consider is it might not all be over in the first couple of laps.
We're absolutely.
A lot of action, but there's pit stops to come. There's an awful lot that can play in this story yet.
Yeah, talk about the pit stops. Tremendous pressure, too, on the teams, changing the wheels. And, well, you only need to have a little bit of finger trouble with the ratchet gun there. And maybe you've dropped a couple of seconds can make all the difference. So, huge sense of anticipation here. And for a DTM race, this Hockenheim circuit, just an hour, south of Frankfurt. Actually, as full as I've seen it for such a race, as they go off now on the warm-up lap. And they go either side of that glass trophy. And I hope the blast of air as they go by doesn't knock it over.
And what a sight, what a sound. This is absolutely awesome here at Hockenheim as they're off on their formation lap. And well done, girls. The trophy stays intact, and thankfully so do they.
Yeah. Just interestingly, looking at the map of the Nürburgring, of Hockenheim there, it looked like a thumbs up.
Yes.
Yeah, because this DTM has mainly German racetracks, but we've got Zandvoort in it as well, and Brands Hatch and the Red Bull Ring from Austria, and Valencia. There's the grid again. The calendar for next year has still not been announced. That should come next week, but we confidently predict that next year Moscow will be in an 11 race schedule, we are told, and that the show race, the show event at Munich Stadium will be dropped. So we anticipate and wait for that. But this is all about today. It's all about the 10th and final race of this 2012 season. Go, Gary, go. Like that. Is that all done with hats or shirts? It's impressive. That's a Mercedes-Benz grandstand, of course. There is Gary Paffett, originally born in Bromley in Kent, just down the road from Brands Hatch, but now lives out in the Suffolk countryside with his family. There's Bruno Spengler with French-Canadian nationality, former Mercedes driver until this year, but was actually born in the Alsace, just near Strasbourg, which is where he still lives.
So we get the images of all the team bosses, Andrew.
Yeah, Jamie Green there as well. Man from Leicester, but now lives in Monte Carlo with his wife and young child.
So fantastic shots we're able to bring you here as the cars on their formation lap here, ready for the big showdown. It is the DTM Championship 2012 as we're on board with Bruno Spengler there. And as nervous as you and I are feeling in the comms box, Andrew, yep, whatever must it be like for those racing drivers?
Gary may be thinking back 10 years when he came here to Hockenheim, the final meeting of the year, with the German Formula 3 Championship at his grasp, and he won it there 10 years ago, and that launched him into a career of Mercedes-Benz. There was a hiccup along the way, we won't go into that right now, but there he is in the Thomas Sabo Mercedes-Benz C-Class two-door, and odd puffs of Hankook tyre smoke at the back as people just have a final blast on their tyres. And there is Paffett, and there is Spengler. Britain versus Canada, but Pfaff as it is on pole. The whole stadium will start to hush as we wait for the lights to come on. There's the teams. Alex Zanardi there in the BMW garage. Five lights, they're out and off, they launch into that first corner.
Spengler's got a brilliant start, Andrew.
Spengler's a magnificent start. We also had a very good start from Mortara. Joey Hand going out wide. He'll come back in, though, and I think his Hand coming back in third place. Down to that tight right hander. I think it's called the Eccleston Curve these days. And again, a few cars going wide, but no real dramas thus far. There is that Hand. It was Hand alongside.
Hand right alongside, yeah. Gary Paffett.
And it's not looking good for Gary Paffett. He's going to have three BMWs in front of him if he's not careful. And look at Ekstrom trying to nudge his Hand. Ekstrom nudges Hand, and Gary Paffett comes back into third place.
And Paffett knew just how to drive that corner. He could see what was going to go wrong there. So now it's down to Gary to absolutely nail that car on this opening lap as Bruno Spengler goes through. Andrew!
Oh, what a surprise. So Bruno Spengler, the plain fact is if Paffett wins the race, he wins the championship. If Spengler wins the race, he wins the championship. It's that simple. Obviously, there could be other combinations, but at the moment, it's going Spengler's way in these very early stages. BMW, I think, ganging up a little bit on Gary. He needed a mate to be in there to help him. But nobody with the same speed. And Jamie Green moved up a couple of places. Green is there in sixth place behind Ekstrom. Look at Bruno Spengler. He's come so close to winning this championship on a number of occasions.
So off the first lap we go. It's Spengler, Farfus, Paffett, Ekstrom, Joey Hand, Jamie Green, Edo Mortara, Dirk Werner.
Last season for the championship was Tomczyk versus Spengler. The season before it was De Resta versus Spengler in China, where it all went wrong for Spengler. But this time, certainly at the start, it's gone his way.
On board with Jamie Green now in the cockpit of the car that's in P6 at the moment. You can see the back end of Joey Hand's BMW in front there. And that's
Tombay. That's crabbing that car. What has happened to... Tombay, well, great second place 3 weeks ago, straight into the garage and out with Tombay. Must have been tapped somewhere.
Andy Prio moving up now. He's into ninth place. He's got ahead of Tomczyk. See Susie Wolf's car there.
Yeah, the two girls running together. Susie would like to beat Rahel Frey this weekend. And Robert Wickens getting nudged out. And a little bit of bodywork flying off his car. Now let's look at some lap times. And Paffett just in the middle sector now goes purple. But the previous lap, Spengler, absolutely fantastic. A 41.524. And damage
yes.
to the front of Ekstrom's car. That shouldn't bother him too much. And the hand there in fourth place. Oh, fifth place. Green sixth. Now, what can Green get up there to try and give some help to Gary Paffett? David Coulthard made a very good start up to 14th. There's Charlie Lamb in heated discussion, of course. Spengler driving for the Charlie Lamb Schnitzer team. Mr. Schnitzer himself was here yesterday. Well, it must have been a puncture on the Audi there.
So Rahel Frey then back out into the...
And Rocky's in the garage, yes. And that looks terminal. What happened to him? So he will probably finish up not the best Audi driver of the season. Well, at the moment, it's going Spengler's way, and he's got Farfus behind him, which is the perfect scenario, really. For BMW at the moment, Paffett third and Ekstrom.
And then, of course, Jamie Green has got Joey Hand in front of him as well. Another BMW there. So it's Paffett and Green, the Mercedes in third and sixth at the moment. There is Jamie Green, the wrap on that car, the shimmering chrome effect on that car.
I get the impression that Green's got a better car under him now than he had in qualifying, though. No smiles on the faces there at the moment. And the gap, 1.5 seconds. Back to Farfus, another second back to Paffett. And Ekstrom's dropped a little way off that grid. And Gary's just got to keep his head down now, keep it clean, see what he can do. But of course, he's got to get past Farfus. Could all happen in the pit stops, of course.
Yes, it can. And the pit stop window from lap 11 to 32, Andrew. Two mandatory pit stops that have to be taken as we watch Bruno Spengler then, who leads this race with Augusto Farfus in second place. Then it is Gary Paffett, then Ekstrom, then Joey Hand. And here we see a replay, Andrew.
Here is that start. A clean one. Look, Paffett made a good start. See, Paffett made an awful start, what am I saying? Paffett made a terrible start, then he got a bump by... Paffett got a good initial launch, and then it seemed to bog down, yeah.
But the one that got the blistering start, in my opinion, was Spengler. He was able, with Paffett just bogging down, to dive to exactly where he needed to be.
So that was the launch. There is Farfus, and then straight through goes Spengler. I'm interested to see what Gary says about this. He very nearly turned Joey Hand around, didn't he?
Yeah.
Hand came across in front of him.
See it from Mickey's car, and you can see there.
I don't think he even did get a good launch, actually. Now I look at it again.
Oh, Joey got a tap there from Mickey.
Yeah, he did.
That's what put him into Paffett.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why we have the damage on Mickey's car. Well, it could have been much worse than that at the start, couldn't it?
Yeah.
And then Farfus just went wide, as I thought he would, to allow Spengler through. Team tactics. Wow, look at the passion there. Do you see Zanardi? Saw Zanardi earlier on demonstrating his special Olympic trike with the
fantastic
medals around
him.
It's absolutely fantastic. That's where Farfus went off there. Just looking up at the messages we get from the race control, but there's none there except that the pit lane window will open on lap 11. Here's the championship prediction at the moment. Spengler 149, Paffett 142, Green 117. Long way to go yet, though.
Yes, there is. We're only on lap four of 42 as we're watching Ekstrom here. He's got Joey Hamm behind, then Jamie Green. There's Farfus, there's Paffett. I know you're...
Tyres are getting up to temperature now.
Constantly looking at that timing screen, Andrew.
Yeah, well, this last lap, Paffett fastest in the first sector, turning it purple, but Spengler in the second. There is the team Paffett. With the wife Lisa down there. Gary, of course, winning this championship now 6 years ago. Paffett just taken the 10th out of Farfus. And Prio up to 9th ahead of Tomczyk. Two Grand Prix drivers running in 11th and 12th. Taurus in 13th. And, well, problems down there, David Tomczyk. And Shumi, they rubbed bodywork, I think they might have done.
Well, there's certainly plenty flapping about on the back of that Mercedes, isn't there? As you can see there now.
That's the battle for 10th.
Battle of circuit.
Ralph goes down the inside, look, tries to make himself a gap. And Tomczyk probably switched down the inside. He's got the inside line for the next corner. Wheel-to-wheel racing here at Hockenheim. DC right in the action as well. Sure he'd like to go out with a decent result.
Yes. So watching our race leader now, the BMW Bank liveried car of Bruno Spengler.
Dave's best result of the season and of his DTM career was at Norris Ring, where he finished fifth. Flags waving, lots of BMW flags there. Farfus in second place, and the gap between Farfus and Paffett holding station just about a second. Joey Hand from California, by far the best showing of him in the DTM. Here's a replay of Hand there. Look at Hand being... Whoa, look at that. That was early on. That's how Gary Paffett moved up a couple of places after his awful start. So, Hand certainly didn't help BMW in that situation.
No, but he's in a great position now to be of real benefit, isn't he?
Paffett just another fastest first sector. First man down into the 20s for that sector. Well, you've got to say, Gary's not giving up without a fight, is he here?
No.
Although it is very early days. And there is Samsung back car of Joey Hand.
Now, Jamie Green really needs to be up there to try and help in some way, but he's got to get past Hand and he's got to get past Ekstrom as well. And at the moment, he is not able to show anything to them at all, is he? Ekstrom, even with the damage on the front, it doesn't seem to be affecting the car, Andrew.
No, I don't think it really is affecting the aerodynamics. I think the splitter's still in good shape there. It's just the bit of grill which is flapping around. There is Spengler in the BMW Bank car, who strived so hard over the last 5 years to try and take this title. He's always been there or thereabouts, but the French-Canadian has never quite managed it. Is this his year? I think we were all a little bit surprised when he switched to BMW from Mercedes-Benz, who basically adopted him from Formula 3, and he's been with them ever since until this year. And it was a masterstroke to hire him. Still victorious there in a very tight battle amongst these cars, behind Martin Tomczyk for 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, maybe even 16th places.
Yes, that is a heck of a battle going on there, isn't it?
But it's all about this at the front.
And there you can see over the last few laps the difference between Spengler and Paffett. So we see Ekstrom, Hand, and Jamie Green on board with Jamie Green now. had an off in the warm-up this morning, Andrew.
Yeah.
Filled that car with stones from the runoff area. No such disasters at the moment, though, as we see Gary Paffett down there in P3. Could so easily, apart from were it not for that slow-mo we saw a moment ago, he could be down there in P6.
He could easily, yeah. Joey Hand opening the door for him. There's Spengler, 1.8 now over Farfus. And Paffett, 0.9 of a second. And this little gap to Ekstrom, Hand, Green, and Mortara.
Information just coming through that under investigation for pushing another car is Robert Wickens.
That's not one we saw. Oh, David Coulthard goes flying. Roberto Meri decides to go round that speed bump. Whoa. Timo Scheider, meanwhile, from the back of the grid, where he was placed because of being underweight in qualifying, he has moved up to 14th place. Timo Scheider, the 2008-2009 champion. Some discussion this morning in the Mercedes meeting with Norbert Haug if he had offered a contract to Timo Scheider. Says, I really like the guy, but I've never ever talked to him about him driving for us. There's Zanardi. Of course, raced in the World Touring Car Championship with BMW, with Hand Controls. Before that, his great career with Ganassi Racing. And of course, not such a wonderful time with Williams in Formula One. We'll return to Champ Car. And remember, his horrible injury was at the Lauschitzring. Spengler. And now that gap is 2 seconds. And Paffett closing up on Farfus. But what can he do about getting by him? Well, now on the pit wall, they're going to be thinking about the strategies.
We're only a couple of laps away, aren't we, from that window opening, Andrew?
And yeah, it's who jumps first, isn't it?
As you said earlier on, you know, it just takes one cross thread, doesn't it?
And these cars will run quicker in fresh air. Gary Paffett can run a bit quicker than that if he isn't right behind that BMW.
Right.
So they'll be wondering when they're going to bring in Farfus. Look, Paffett's right on the tail of the Brazilian now.
So there goes through Farfus there. Gary Paffett. Bruno Spengler just going through there, leading this race. And if it stays this way, the championship goes the way of Bruno Spengler. But there's an awful lot that can happen yet.
Oh, absolutely. Just looking at the lap time, Spengler 36.5, Gary 36.5 the last lap, and he's really harrying at the back of the Brazilians now. And there, the Red Bull car of Ekstrom, Jamie Green still trying to get on terms with the others to help Gary Paffett, and Green in front of Joey Hand. You might see that in a replay in a moment. Here it is, down at the hairpin, lovely move, and collision as well. So Hand learning about the DTM.
Yeah.
So Green trying to get on terms. Green 10 seconds behind Spengler at the moment, 10.7 to be exact. So the great things about Hockenheim is you can overtake here.
Yes. So the Thomas Sabo Mercedes then. Farfus has just seemed to resist the challenge from Paffett just for a moment. Now, as you say, they'll be working hard on the pit wall, deciding the best strategy now for Gary Paffett, won't they, Andrew?
Yeah, because sometimes they both jump at the same time.
Yep.
The window will open the end of this lap. There's Norbert Haug with some senior members of Mercedes-Benz. Stalking there, and they're getting ready for the pit stop.
On! Farfus dives in, so does Paffett.
Well, this could be down to this pit stop here, second place. Paffett turns in, as does Farfus. And Ekstrom comes in as well. There's Paffett now. That was close. That was very close indeed. Didn't have a clock on that. Oh, and that's close as well. And they're side by side as they go out. And Paffett gets it. Paffett gets it as they blast through back onto the racetrack. Game on. And Ralf Schumacher still with that bit of bodywork training. He needs to keep it out of the way. And one of these... Well, he's managed to get in front of Farfus.
Yeah.
What can Ralf do?
Acting as a...
Well, no, actually, Farfus is going to go through now.
What a...
Well, I'd like to see that pit stop again. I'm sure we will.
That was incredible. Absolutely incredible.
So, we'll wait for Spengler's pit stop. See what happens in that. Pressure's on the boys from Schnitzer now.
Isn't it just?
And that is Ekstrom parked up. What happened to him? We didn't see that.
No, we saw him come in.
So that will move Mortara up. Spengler in now.
Now they've got to do this right, Andrew.
They've got to do one of those 3 second stops, haven't they? He's also got to get a good exit as well. 2.7, fantastic.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, Charlie Lamb drills those boys so well. He's going to come out and with a decent buffer over Gary Paffett. Well, at least Gary's got his target in sight now without anybody in the way. Jamie Green, slow stop there with Green. And Mortara just behind him. Prio hasn't stopped yet. See, Joey Han leads. Must be the first American. I know Danny Sullivan did a couple of races years ago with Alfa Romeo, but I think he must be the first American to lead a DTM race. And Werner there also out. Prio, so three BMWs out front at the moment by dint of not making a pit stop.
So there we see Ecky's car once again, Andrew.
Just pulled it off. Some mechanical failure. We'll see what it is.
Yeah, we saw him in. He followed Paffett and.
Yeah, he did, and they obviously hadn't put the nut on correctly, and that's the end of Ecky's season.
But that serves as a great illustration to us what can happen in those pit stops, Andrew.
Yeah, and Spengler just bouncing it over the curbs.
So we've got Prio ahead of him now.
Yeah, Randy will make sure he finds a nice clean path through.
And he actually in second place on track at the moment. Not taking a stop yet. There's Augusto Farfus.
Well, Spengler's lead over Gary Paffett has increased after those pits. So here it is, Farfus. Gary getting out.
Now, will that be allowed, Andrew? I mean, that was really...
I think so.
Yep.
I think so. No message from the race direction anyway. And I think they would have flashed it up by now.
Here we see it from on board Augusto's car. Boy, they were close.
And Gary had to, basically Farfus had to lift, didn't he, to let Gary through.
And this was the stop that went wrong for Jamie Green.
Yeah, problem with the right front. There is Farfus. Prio staying out. we'll be monitoring the lap time, see whether Gary has got a good second set of tyres. Tyre situation between Spengler and Paffett was exactly the same. They had the, I think they both had one new set to use.
Yep. So there is Gary Paffett.
And Spengler very quick out of the box with a 136.6, but Paffett 136.1. Still very much on for Paffett, you know, Dave.
So Spengler, a 135.6.
Yeah. I want Prio to go into the pit so we really see
yeah.
what's going to happen between these two boys at the front.
So Spengler.
Yeah, it's 3.5 seconds between Spengler and Paffett. And Farfa still following in the wake of the British driver. Of course, British driver Paul de Resta won this championship 2 years ago. Moved straight on to Formula One, where he's been doing a great job for Force India.
So Spengler then, fastest lap, 135.6.
He's really put a quick one in there.
So
yeah, he took half a second out of Gary that lap.
Some debris down there on the track, Andrew.
Yes, there is.
Oh, Gary Paffett under investigation.
That would be for the
that's gotta
launch,
be for that.
Yeah.
That's got to be for that pit stop.
It has. I don't want it to be decided on that.
No.
Gary was just told to go. He goes when he's told.
Yep.
He can't see out of the left-hand side, see what's happening. Well, obviously, once he was launched, then he could. And there's a Ralph's car with the chunk missing out the back. Well, this will be a disaster for the sporting side of this if Gary gets a drive-through.
Well, we await.
And, the driver steward of this weekend is Danny La Rosa, former DTM driver and now F3 commentator. There's that piece of bodywork. Oh, it got destroyed, didn't it, by Molina.
So at the moment then, we have no further information to bring you as soon as we see anything. Of course, we'll bring that straight to you, but there is Gary Paffett then running down there in third at the moment, but it's a bit academic saying that because Prio is in front and Prio hasn't stopped yet as the family look on. And,
yep.
Gary taking a bit of the rumble strip there.
And this is certainly living up to expectations.
Andy Prio now getting the blue flag. Well, you're right.
To be a fly on the wall in that steward's room at the moment.
So Prio yields then, and now the race is back on, Andrew.
Yep. Prio drops behind Farfus on a completely different strategy on the tyres. Maybe this will come to him a bit later in the race. Andy Prio desperate to get in the top five or six. And there you see the two black cars out front. And the gap, 3 seconds. Paffett hasn't shaken off Farfus yet. Green in fifth place. And has dropped back to eighth now. And it's just up Prio that hasn't made the pit stop. There's Paffett in the stadium section pulling loads of G. They're still discussing that incident in the stewards' room. No ruling as yet.
So 3.6 seconds the gap, Andrew.
Yeah, Paffett just took a little time out of Spengler that lap. It's only 0.2 of a second. He's got to really work his way. Whoa, keep his head down, look at that.
So we zoom in on the Thomas Sabo Mercedes then. The race on, the target of Spengler's BMW very much in Gary Paffett's sights.
Well, he can see him, can't he? He knows how much he's got to do around the hairpin. Farfus. Then Prio on that long first stint. And then Green. Green 15 seconds behind Spengler. And it's Werner, Mortara, Hand, Ralf Schumacher, and Vitoris. Coulthard in 11th, then Albuquerque. Timo Scheider is 13th, and it's Tomczyk, Wolf, Wickens, Merry.
So the two drivers then in their cockpits, battling hard around this Hockenheim circuit. Gary Paffett and Bruno Spengler there, both, to be fair, looking as cool as cucumbers out there, Andrew, doing the job that they are absolutely brilliant at and providing us with some scintillating racing.
Maximum concentration for both of them. Similar lap times at the moment.
Andy Prio comes in for his pit stop then, as a little bit more is added to the message from earlier. It is the unsafe release that's being investigated.
So where's Prio going to cycle back in? Nice little battle between Mortara and Han going on for sixth place. Rob Wickham tried to overtake Susie Stoddard, and Roberto Merry came diving down the middle of them. It could have all ended a great heat, but it didn't somehow.
Yes, that could have been a big Mercedes heap, couldn't it?
Merry, the reigning Formula 3 European champion, his fellow Spaniard Dani Junqueira, crown champion today earlier on. Merry found it pretty difficult making the switch to DTM. And the gap between the two leading contenders now, 3.5 seconds. No further action. That's
further
great
action,
news.
Andrew.
Great news.
So now it is down to what happens on the track.
And at the moment, Paffett is just chiseling the odd tenth off that lead. But it's just the odd tenth.
So there is Gary Paffett.
Last lap, Paffett took a little bit more out of Spengler. Sometimes we wonder about how strong Spengler's head is.
Yes.
You know, a couple of seasons, he really has, at the last race or two, seemed to suffer some bad nerves and some self-belief. But under Charlie Lamb's tuition, he seems to have been a stronger man all round this year. But what will happen if Gary starts to put some pressure on him? There you see the gap.
Yes.
What do you call it? 12 car lengths. So it's no more.
And
it equates to, at the moment, 3.3 seconds.
There is the prediction as it stands at the moment.
Yep. Well, those 4 points are everything.
Well. And, of course, what we need to factor in, Andrew, is another round of pit stops to come. Some have already taken two, but Spengler hasn't, Paffett hasn't, Farfus hasn't, and Green hasn't. They're the 1, 2, 3, 4 at the moment.
And just you have to take your hat off to that Schnitzer team. Just to say again, there will be no further action against Gary Paffett for an unsafe release. There you have it on the screen. We think that's great news. We want this race to go right to the wire. Just see if Paffett can keep chiseling away. And that is what he's doing every lap.
Yes.
Last four or five, he's just taken another tenth of a second off.
Working really hard out there.
And Farfus is hanging on, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
In third place. Green now in fourth, but Green is some 10 seconds down the road behind Farfus.
And there is Jamie Green.
He's putting in decent lap times, similar lap times to Gary Paffett. Norbert Haug, bit of politicking going on, I think. I think all the Mercedes bigwigs are here. Normally, would be up on the front bench there.
Yes.
Leaving it today to Gerhard Unger. The next season will be joined by Eric Lux. BMW, of course, has strengthened their technical squad with Chris Dyer, ex of Ferrari, as Ron Wickens turns it into the garage to bring an end to his first season in the DTM. We're told he has a contract for next year, the Canadian. We call Spengler French Canadian. I suppose we call him the English Canadian.
Yes. So we focus on Gary Paffett then.
All about tenth, so isn't it, Dave, at the moment? Look.
Yes, it is. And we're exactly halfway through, Andrew.
Yep, and Paffett again just chiseled away another tenth. Still 3.1.
There's Jamie Green, distant way back in fourth place.
Just if he'd had a better qualifying, he might have been able to play a bigger part in this. And then Dirk Werner, what a super season he's had.
So Edo Mortara comes in then, Andrew. Also in is Prio, 3.1.
Yeah, that was a very short first stint, wasn't it? Right behind Mortara. He only did about five laps on that second set.
Yes.
Green just gone purple in the first sector.
Prio going for a move around the outside of Mortaro. Very nearly came to grief there. Managed to hold on. Brilliant car control from Andy Prio. Doubtless we'll see a replay of that. Here it comes, Andrew. Look at this.
Yeah, the man from Guernsey.
Whoa. Just got the rear wheel up on the grass.
Did crank the opposite lock on to straighten it out. I think Andy will be pretty happy with this drive. Showing he can be competitive in one of these cars. It's been a bit of a nightmare of a season for him. Of course, he had the sixth place here at the start of the season.
Right at the start, yes.
And then all seems to have gone backwards from there.
Right. Let's have a look here, Andrew, as the pit crew gets ready. Now, what is the strategy there?
Well, we'll have to wait and see. They're waiting for Ralph, who is running in ninth place.
Coulthard's
season comes to an end in his professional career. Well, I think, it's still going. What was all that smoke?
Yeah, what was all that smoke? So Schumacher in then.
Fresh set of rubber going on the Schumi car.
3.8.
Paffett just fastest in the first sector, gone purple.
And that was
that's what it was.
Smoke from Schumi there.
I think Timo Scheiner turning him around.
And that was the smoke as he lit it up to get it round again. And could almost hear Timo saying, see ya. As David Coulthard
comes diving in, but he's just going to get a fresh set of rubber on, a bit of a mark on the front of the car, but not too bad, and he's going to continue. The man originally from Scotland, just close to Dumfries, where the family still run a haulage contractor business.
Right.
Farfus comes in then. And that gap between Spengler and Paffett is now 3 seconds.
So there goes Augusto Farfus then, 3.9, the pit stop for Augusto.
Well, Bruno Spengler doesn't want one of those. He wants another 2.8
yes.
stop, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
For Taurus in the gold for this race meeting. Mercedes car. Taurus, remember, promoted this year to the full HWA, the top team. And had what has to be said, disappointing season, really, in 11th place. Fourth position in the opening round, his best result.
So there is Bruno Spengler.
Yeah, and Gary Paffett's now got car in between them. And Gary's wringing everything out of this that he can.
Dives in this time, Andrew.
Yeah, wonder if he's got a decent set of tyres. There isn't much difference between the sets, but sometimes they just feel a little variation. It helps their confidence. They get a set that they really like. Third and final set to go on.
So looking for a good time from the team here.
Yeah, there he's got a set which has been on the car before, as you can see. And they reckon if you have an absolutely fresh set on, it can give you about a second and a half. And then they sort of bed in and then it plateaus out. So a new set is worth about a second and a half.
And Coulthard,
end of his professional racing career, an era is over, and a great ambassador for the sport, a great race winner, 13 Grand Prix victories, and it all comes to an end in the garage at Hockenheim.
So Spengler out on his own now. He's got another mandatory pit stop to take.
Yep. So all the time skewed around a bit at the moment. Bit of a shrug of the shoulders from DC. Sure why the scrutineer was shaking his head.
No.
I think this is waiting for Spengler.
So we're on board with him now. Sure
and
enough.
He dives in.
Right.
Let's see if the Schnitzer boys can get it all right again and do another of those sub 3 second stops. Remember, the gap between Spengler and Paffett is only about 3 seconds. 2.9 this time, another great stop. It's also about how quickly you get in and get on the brakes and then get out again. Seems to have got out into a fresh air, and there is Gary Paffett.
In
as green comes in.
Green.
3.3 for green.
Right, so with both the pit stops done, Andrew, it's down to...
Yeah, this is the dash to the line, 25 laps in the book. And now Dirk Werner, let's see, he just moves out of the way, and I think he's going to. Yeah, sportsmanlike. And Paffett goes through, and...
The chase is on.
Yeah, the chase is absolutely on there. Tomczyk, he has made his last pit stop of the season. And then that just established that Gary really got out the first sector very quick indeed.
So on board with Gary, looking at the concentration through the crash helmet there of the pilot of this car around the slight bank in there, Andrew.
Yeah, he's using that outside line. Different drivers use different lines through there, using the lip of the banking to pull him round. Just standing there in practice earlier on, Dave. They're so impressive through there. Werner comes in.
the moment. We've got a lot of BMWs around Gary Paffett and of course Jamie Green. Hand yet to make his second stop. I think he'll drop to seventh, I think.
Nonetheless, great showing from Joey Hand. Looked good in free practice, looked good in quali, Andrew.
Yeah, well, what's happened in those pit stops is that Spengler has increased the lead back to 4 seconds.
But Gary sets now the fastest lap.
Oh, Molina's in the gravel. Magic Molina. And he's not had a great year, has he, really? In fact, he's only scored on a couple of occasions this season. Wonder if his position at Audi is in jeopardy. Promised so much as a teenager. He's very quick in Renault 3.5, a single-seater driver. Had an excellent rookie year, but doesn't look so good now for Molina as Paffett crosses the line again. And Paffett took a chunk out of Spengler. That lap, 0.6 of a second he took out of him.
Well, the gap now is, well, it's visibly coming down, Andrew, isn't
yep.
it?
Yep. Timo Scheider, drive-through penalty for pushing another car.
That, of course.
Remember, he turned DC around.
Yeah.
And there is Molina's car. So, really an awful season for the former champion. Sixth place at the Lausch, it's his best result of the year. That's how he turned DC around and pushed DC into retirement as a result of that.
So drive through served and back out there.
Three yellow flag out at the Sachs curve at the moment. That's for Molina's car.
So there.
Another fastest sector of the race for Gary Paffett. Just wait to see how much he's pulled in the black BMW in front of him this time. And it's down to 2.8 seconds. That's the closest it's been for a long time. And Paffett is really hunting after his prey now. Well, all the publicity beforehand, David's really lived up to that. It's a real straight fight between the two top men in the DTM this year. Look at Paffett, he's got him right in his sights now.
Yes, he has.
Spengler unhappy with his tyres. I remember, whoever wins this battle wins the championship. It's as simple as that.
Yes, it couldn't have been scripted better for us, could it? It's been highs and lows and drama all the way to the final showdown.
Gary Paffett's awful start, and then the Joey Hands incident let him go through two places. And now closing up on him. There we see them again, both concentrating, absolutely focused. Paffett will have taken another bit out of Spengler this lap, just looking at the splits. Did you just see Spengler looking in the mirror then? His eyes just flicked across this. Jens Marquardt. Whatever happens today, you can be proud of the success. Proud of BMW's return to the DTM. Now it's 2.2 seconds. Marfa's 5 seconds behind. It's just about these two men at the front. The French-Canadian and the Brit. Both with huge amounts of experience. down at the hairpin. Right down to 32, 33 miles an hour. From this lap, will it go under 2 seconds, the gap? Sun's still shining here at Hockenheim on this 10th and final cliffhanging round of the DTM.
135.402 as Paffett posts yet another fastest lap, absolutely meaning business out there now in his quest to try and overhaul the race-leading Bruno Spengler. This for the DTM Championship 2012 with just over 12 laps left to run, Andrew.
Yeah, only 12 laps of this cliffhanger here. And they complete another lap. And what is the gap this time? Well, you can see what the gap is, but on the stopwatch, it's down to 2 seconds.
So he's taken another 2/10 out.
Yeah, Paffett still lapping quicker there. Farfus in a clear third place, the man who was on pole position. And then it's green, and then it'll be Vernon still. Well, literally, it's finger biting.
It is.
It's nail biting.
Norbert Haug is there on the pit perch now.
Gerhard Unger from HWA, who's the technical brains behind all this, and put back the absolute nightmare of Valencia, where Mercedes just was so far off the pace. Prio, incidentally, is in front of hand. There they are. And Ralf Schumacher with the bodywork hanging off. After qualifying yesterday, Ralf was absolutely furious. A bit of shouting at his engineer. Never quite come to the bottom of why they made some change to his car that he didn't like, said he didn't know about. Mortara got two BMWs right behind him.
Hand and Prio having their own little battle there.
Well, this battle at the front, it's inch by inch that Paffett's closing on Spengler.
But closing he is, Andrew.
Closing he is, as you say.
2/10 down last time.
Let's see this time. Really trying hard there, Gary. Just losing a bit of time, I would say, out there.
But even so, still taking another 2/10 out, Andrew.
Yep, it's down to 1.8 seconds now. We could have a real grandstand finish here, couldn't we? Oh, and Gary locks up on the back brakes. You see how hard he's pushing now. Making some little mistakes, but still somehow getting away with it. Locked the rears. And Spengler can see him now. And the gap closing all the time.
So up to the hairpin they go then. Fantastic heli shot that we're able to bring you. Down to just 30 miles an hour. First gear through there. There is Gary Paffett and Spengler well within his sights now, driving like an absolute demon to try and get on terms with this BMW, taking tenths of seconds out, lap after lap after lap.
Just over 10 laps to go here at Hockenheim. Spengler versus Paffett. Farfus is in third place, way back. Green is fourth, Werner and Mortara. And then it's Andy Prio. And then Hand and Ralf Schumacher and Vittorius are the top 10. And that was the lockup with Gary, just locked the rears there. Look at the.
Yeah.
But despite that lockup, I think Gary took a little bit of time out of him that lap. See when.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, he did. It took. So it's now 1.3 seconds, and now they are only a couple of four car lengths apart. That's Bruno's girlfriend, Franzi. Don't tell me that Spengler can be denied this championship, but again, he's got so close so many times. But Gary Paffett, what a pro he is. And look, that shows the story, doesn't
it? Yes, doesn't it, Joe?
And then, of course, once he gets onto the boot of the black BMW, he's got to get past it. At least here at Hockenheim, there are opportunities, there are places. Look at Spengler.
10 laps left to run, Andrew.
As we said, nail-biting stuff, a real cliffhanger here. Pavic just seems to have that bit more speed, doesn't he, on this final set of tyres. That man there in the middle might be driving one of these BMWs next year, the test driver, Marco Wittmann.
Yeah.
BMW have announced they will go up to 8 cars next year. Wittmann is expected to drive one of them. Former Formula 3 ace.
Right,
across the line. Let's see what the gap is now. It was 1.3, and now it is 1.2.
Oh, Andrew.
He just chipping away at it, chipping away at it. Because it only needs one missed break, doesn't it, down there, and it'll be all, could be over for Spengler as far as the championship is concerned. But by the same token, Gary could make a mistake and drop right back.
And they could, of course, challenge each other and both end up in a heap.
Yeah, well, if they do, and they go out,
Jamie Green will be there.
Well, he won't, because Farfus is in front of Green.
Ah.
It won't be enough. If that happens, if they finish up in a heap, and Gary might, I hope he's not thinking about this, then he wins the championship.
Right.
Because Green can't. Unless Farfus slowed up, be no point.
So there is Spengler and there is Paffett then, as the laps are counting down.
Yeah, still 9 to go, 8 to go. Jens Marquardt, what a first year as the boss of BMW for him.
And as we've said, in whatever way it's measured, it's been nothing other than an absolute success for BMW. Never did we think that perhaps we would be here at the final round with the potential for the championship to be won by BMW, new into or returning into the DTM this year. And here we have BMW and Mercedes fighting it out.
And on this lap, for the first time in about 10 or 12, I think maybe Spengler has increased the lead a little bit. Well, no, he hasn't. No, Gary took 0.03 of a second out of him that lap.
Right.
Farfus still in the third spot, some 7.5 seconds behind this battling duo of black machines. Lights on for Spengler, no lights on for the Mercedes C-Class Coupe. Remember, the both cars share a lot of common parts. Black and white flag for Paffett is being warned. That was earlier on, Dave, that we saw. That was about 5 laps ago.
Now,
talk about tense. Talk about tense.
So there is Gary Paffett now. He's got to keep that car within the white lines, Andrew, because we've seen drivers penalised, haven't we?
Oh, yeah, he can't do that again, I don't think. He's round the Sachs curve.
So in his quest to chase down Bruno Spengler, he's got to be so, so careful.
And there, this time, Spengler has just widened the gap by a fraction. Spengler goes out very wide. Gary keeps at least one wheel on the curb.
The tension
all round here.
Oh, Andrew, the tension.
Yep. This is what motor racing is about. This is why it's such a huge sport. This is why the manufacturers are in it. BMW fans are out there aplenty. We're seeing all the flags, the Mercedes fans. Not so much for the Audi aficionados to cheer today. That's a sort of concertina effect there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Gary just misses the apex a little bit. Shows how hard he is trying.
Mm. So there is the race leading Bruno Spengler.
Still with his mirrors full of the Mercedes-Benz into the stadium section again. Can he hang on for another seven laps? Again, I think Gary's gone back a bit closer again this time. 1.2. This is the championship prediction. Still, it'll be 4 points more for Spengler than Baffett. Further down the field, not surprising we aren't watching it, but Prio and Hand and Ralf Schumacher are all running very close together.
Yep. But this is what we're focusing on and what you would expect as both the drivers in there, as we see them at work in their cockpit, the focus, the concentration.
On the pit wall, Dave, they'll be watching every split as we are doing. Look at Paffett there, working away. Bit of emotion down there.
Whilst all that's going on, Roberto Meri gets the black and white flag as well for leaving the track. So, very consistent with the warnings, Andrew.
Again, I think this lap, Paffett will have chipped another bit away. Is this championship going to be decided by 1 second?
1.1.
One at the moment. Well, we couldn't have asked for a better finale to this, could we? Beautiful weather. And a cracking battle between the two main contenders. Absolutely there, trading 10th of a second for 10th of a second. And if it stays like this, I think Gary Paffett is there, he's gone off wide again. Gary Paffett is, look at them there on BMW. Gary Paffett is going to rue that start, isn't he?
Yeah, and he will rue the points that he's missed during the course of the season, of course, Andrew.
Well, there's so many ifs and buts in motor racing.
So there is Spengler, there is Paffett. Remains at 1.1, Andrew.
Yeah, now they've got Roberto Meri in their sights, about to lap him. Well, Norbert says they always play it fair with Mercedes, so hopefully Meri will keep way out of the way as the BMW flags wave. 37 laps. Now it's going to be 38 in the book.
Just four to run.
There, our clock shows that it's still 1.1. There's Meri in your picture. Bruno Spengler, long-time Mercedes driver now in BMW. Look in his mirror and see that three-pointed star on the front of Gary Paffett's car. Mercedes with that huge history in motor racing. Going all the way back, over 100 years. Spengler keeping his cool.
Yes.
Just concentrating on perfect lap times. These Hankook tyres do retain their performance, certainly through a stint like this. Shouldn't be any issues there. What about brakes? Are they still in good condition? Gerhard Unger is bumping up and down a bit. He's been in the sport a long time. In the stadium section again. And another lap is reeled off. And another lap that Bruno Spengler comes closer to that elusive DTM championship. And indeed, he's pulled out quite a bit on that lap. Oh, fingers crossed. So what happened there? Gary suddenly lost half a second. See anything, Dave?
No, I just wonder whether it is Gary just focusing so hard on keeping the car on the track and knowing that he's under a black and white warning already. He can't afford, can he, to...
There's Charlie Lamb in the middle. Prio Hand and Ralf Schumacher still fighting a battle, incidentally, further down the field.
So a backmarking BMW and Mercedes are in their sights now.
And they haven't caught up with the mirror yet.
No.
Well, Spengler's turned out to be an inspired signing by Jens Marquardt. Given the team excellent technical feedback. 128,000 people here. That's about 10,000 more than last year. And they're seeing a great show.
So Mary being shown the
blue flag. Yeah.
And Spengler right on the back of them now.
Oh, we couldn't get out of the way much further than that, could you?
No, he couldn't. Now, Mary.
Well, Mary really, he has got out of the way, actually. He's played the right game there. And Mary's let them both through. And then Norbert can't sit easily, can he? Shuffling about on his seat. Oh, so close at the moment to that finish line. A smile from Franzi. Sort of resigned look on their faces now.
Yeah, but...
Baffett has done everything, hasn't he? And the gap is still 1.5 seconds. It's the flags wave again. Head on to the final lap. And there we've got our counter clock going. And it's now 1.361. It's hardly anything and it's everything.
So the last lap, Andrew.
This is it, the end of the 10 race. Magnificent season for the DTM with the new cars and BMW coming in. And this will be the icing on the cake for them. Lips are pursed, fingers are crossed.
Can Gary pull something out? It's a lot, it's a big ask.
No, it's a big ask now. Look at Spengler's concentration. Well, the picture tells it all. Doesn't need commentators now. Spengler turns in. Just a few corners. Gary's kids wave at the camera. In the stadium section now, into the Sachs curve, just two corners left to go and the checkered flag and a famous championship victory for Bruno Spengler. The French Canadian, here he is heading towards the line and he wins the race. The fireworks go off, they shake our commentary box and he locks it up. And Bruno Spengler has won the 2012 DTM in great style, coming under enormous pressure from Gary Paffett, who did his absolute maximum, but it was all down in the end to that start. And BMW celebrate. And look at Bruno, he's giving his thumbs up, I think, to Farfus.
You've seen him lose it so many times, yeah. Andrew, because he's been so close and his head has just gone away.
Oh, look at Gary, the way he just put his hand down on that wheel.
And, well, what a return to the DTM for BMW, Andrew.
Yeah, after 19 years. I think they can hardly believe it. This car was quick out of the box.
Yes.
They had the advantage, of course, of being able to design a new engine, although the rules are very tight. But Bruno Spengler has delivered, and now I think he's welling up in that crash helmet.
Yes, I think you're right.
Close. It's four, even five times.
There's Jens Marquardt, the...
Yep.
Well... the boss of BMW, who's overseen this return.
What are those scarves about? Never? Something. And Verena is there with Jens Marquardt. Let's find out about those scarves, Verena.
Yes, I'm here with Jens Marquardt. First of all, congratulations. It was an unbelievable success story. The comeback of BMW and claiming the title. How do you feel?
I can't really tell you what's inside, but this is really amazing. And this is such a fantastic team, and they deserve this so much. And to Bruno, who really deserves this championship, I think we've seen today, he drove it from the front, fantastic. And Team Schnitzer, super pit stops, good strategy, everything. So I'm so happy for him, and I'm so happy for my team. I'm so proud of them all, and for BMW in the first season after a return, winning five races and the championship is just incredible.
Congratulations, fantastic job. And back to you guys.
Yeah, thanks very much. And that shot, a win call, it says on the board. Bruno just giving them a face full of Hankook smoke, fireworks still going off here. And that's how he celebrated, and now beating his helmet. Well, we'll look forward to the scenes when he gets back into Parc Fermé and climbs from the car, and I will guarantee you one thing, he will throw himself on the bonnet of that car. His customary way of celebrating a victory. More shots, repeats of the fireworks going off, and Spengler's finish. Gary Paffett in the end losing by 2.2 seconds. It was ultimately all in that start where the car just bogged down. Had it not done that, it might have been a different story. But it was a fair fight as well. And a great advertisement for this hugely professional championship. News coming through this week that the rules will be adopted by Japan. Let's just confirm the result of Spengler from Paffett and Farfus on the podium. Then it's Green, Werner Mortara, Priot with seventh place from Joey Hand, Schumacher, Vitoris going through there, and quite a lot of retirements. Timo Scheider, 12th. Susie Wolf ends her career with a 13th.
Yes, I'm now here with Gary, who must be absolutely gutted. You were trying your very, very best, pushing till the very end, but I guess maybe it comes down to maybe the start?
Obviously, yeah. I mean, the starts have been really good all year, but today I just got a lot of wheel spin off the start and I just didn't get any traction for some reason. So, from there it was nearly impossible, and I did all I could. We got very close in the end, but just not enough, so...
And being so close to the title and then not making it, how does that feel? How gutted are you?
It's really bad. I mean, you know, today wasn't great, but unfortunately we lost the championship early on in the year. You know, we lost a lot of points. We were a long way ahead and we lost a lot of points, and that's what made it so close. So we should have won the championship a long time ago. So that's the biggest disappointment, really. The performance today wasn't that bad, but you know, we lost too many points in the mid part of the season. So,
and do you have any words for Bruno?
Well, he's done a good job. He's been, you know, very fast. We know Bruno's quick, and he's done a very good job. He didn't make any mistakes today. So, yeah.
Thank you very much, Gary. Very disappointed, Gary, there, obviously. I think we all understand that. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Verena. And yes, Andrew, that just reinforces what I said earlier on, doesn't it, about the fact that there were so many missed opportunities, so many points that could have been bagged that weren't.
Yeah, but particularly that Zandvoort incident with Tomczyk. I think Mercedes feel that a lot. But there were other incidents as well. There, the Schnitzer team celebrating. This is not good for BMW. It's not good, sorry, for Mercedes-Benz, but it's great for the championship and
absolutely,
the series and the DTM in general.
And, you know, manufacturers will look at this and think, well, hang on a minute.
Well, I was saying a few moments ago, there's the Constructors' Championship, and BMW just snicking it from Audi.
Yes.
So they've taken all the spoils, the Teams' Championship, the Constructors' Championship and the Drivers' Championship. I mean, it couldn't be better for them. The crowd start to flock away now. And now we can have Farina with our new champion.
Here he is, the new DTM champ 2012, Bruno Spengler. Congratulations, a perfect race. What do you feel?
It's really hard to describe my feelings right now, but when I went through the last corners, I had goosebumps everywhere on my whole body. And I was just screaming in the radio. I think I'm going to lose my voice soon, but I mean, I feel great. The season has been fantastic. The BMW was amazing. The whole team was amazing with me. I had great support. BMW built a great car, you know. The whole improvement from the car through the whole year. I mean, it was hard work for everybody, very hard work. And really, really thank you to the team. Alone, you never win. And I have a great team behind me, and we all won together today. And I'm so happy and so proud to bring that title to BMW in the first year. That's amazing for us.
And how fast is your heart beating right now?
It's about 220, I guess.
All right. Congratulations, Bruno. And back to you guys.
And you know what? Before he got in the car, he put his left boot on first and his right boot on second. And he does that every time. But we haven't seen him leap on the bonnet, which he normally does. Instead, I suppose this year as a champion, you have to have a new symbol. And it's standing there and doing this little devil symbol he has that he picked up. But apparently his engineer said to him, "You're a devil," and made a little sign with his two fingers by his head, and he's adopted that. I think there it says you can buy your ticket for next year.
Ooh.
Except we don't know exactly when the races are going to be yet. Good leap.
That was a good leap.
Double windmill. With double pike, I think.
And just look at thousands and thousands here.
Win on Sunday, sell on Monday. This is great for BMW. Of course, they had years doing well in the World Touring Car Championship, but not quite the same as the DTM. Going to have the national anthem, "O Canada," sung in a moment.
Just
Yeah, nice to see the flag with the maple leaf down there in the crowd.
Doesn't it add something having the anthem sung live? And nice frock, if I may say, Andrew. I like that. Shimmering silver.
And there the Canadian flag in the middle, which says it all. And the president and CEO of Hankook Europe hands over the trophy. And in the end, it's just over 2 seconds, the gap between him and Gary Baffett. The Bavarian Minister of State, Thomas Kruse, hands over a trophy to Charlie Lamb. Out of all his success over 20 or so years, Charlie Lamb has got to be one of the sweetest. In a way, from motor racing point of view, Charlie Lamb and Schnitzer, the old face of BMW, new teams coming up. Axel Versthorn, the vice president there from Deutsche Post, hands over the trophy to Gary Paffett. And Farfus receives a trophy from a German pop star.
Doro Pesch.
Well, so much could have gone wrong, Dave. We had could have had big shunts on the first lap. We could have had the rain pouring down, but the sun shone. We had a good, clean fight. And in the end, as Gary said, it was all down to too much wheel spin at the start.
Yep.
Now, if he'd made a good launch, I wonder what would have happened. And now we can hear from the man who finished third and the end to a great first season in the DTM, Augusto Farfus with Verena.
Yes, I'm now here with Augusto. You certainly fought really hard, starting from pole, ending up in third place. Probably not what you wanted, but are you quite happy with the third place nevertheless?
Wow, it's amazing. It's amazing to be so often on the podium, to have two strong races at the end of the season, especially to see Bruno winning the championship, and wow, it's a dream, to be honest, to have a comeback in such a way. So very well done to Bruno, very well done to whole BMW, also to Gary, to be fair, whole season. So I think the spectators, everybody who was here, had a wonderful Sunday, clean race, fair race, and a well-deserved championship for Bruno.
And also, we saw on the pit stop, it was really, really close between you and Gary, and in the maneuver in the end, you pulled away. That was very, very fair of you.
Yeah, well, I said since the beginning, since yesterday, that I didn't want to disturb on the championship. I didn't want to be part of the championship. For me, I want to do my race. They had a little bit better stop, so was close. I could have squeezed him in. I could have had done an unfair maneuver, but for me, it was just a matter to let them two fight for the championship and be away out of it. So I'm pleased that everything went smooth and we brought the championship home.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Augusto, and back to you guys.
Nice words from the man from Curitiba. Now we're going to get the presentation of the championship. Waiting for Bruno to go up. We will receive another bottle of the Henkel Trocken, which I no doubt he'll spray all over the show. And another leap, not quite so high this time. Oh, I wonder if we're going to get the national anthem again. We might. Another rendition of O Canada. now the trophy, which we've seen at every meeting, Dave, in a
yes.
special cabinet, is pulled out of that cabinet. And I think it's a wonderful glass trophy. It's going to be presented in just a moment. And here it comes. First, the third place trophy is presented to Jamie Green. Second place trophy, not the one that Gary Paffett wanted.
No.
But he receives that. And now, I guess, an even bigger version for Bruno Spengler. Chairman of the board of Robert Bosch, Volkmar Denner presents that. Oh, he can hardly lift it, it's so heavy. Oh, I hope he doesn't drop it.
No.
This is ESPN.